Alright, let's do it.
Last night we just kind of, during our worship night, it was our little impromptu extra, and I love it because all the kids love this song. It talks about when we move our feet, when we open our mouth, the darkness flees. And this song that we're singing right now is just an expression of the fact that our praises rise to the Lord, and it becomes something so strong and powerful in our lives. It makes the darkness flee. So I know it's 9 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday, but we're going to praise the Lord, and we're going to release a sound this morning that's going to break through it. Oh, Father God, we're going to give it to you this Lord. We're going to give it to you this morning, Lord, that you have it as a weapon in your hand. Hallelujah. Let our praises.
Let our praises rise like a weapon in your hand. Praises rise, oh God. Let our praises rise like a weapon in your hand.
Your hand, praises rise, oh God.
Just like that it can change. Oh, when we open up and
to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There's power.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain.
Trust in the name Jesus. Oh, there's no more fear when we say the name Jesus.
No more fear, yeah.
Oh, just break every chain, every chain, every chain. And break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. And break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Oh, he's here to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Jehovah Gabor is here to break it, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break it, break it.
Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
from my enemy till all my fears are gone, and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Oh,
for each and every one of us. It doesn't matter what your sin looks like. The picture the Lord showed me was the prodigal son, and he was digging around in the pig pen and eating the pig slop. And the moment when the realization came that there's a father who loves me and I don't have to be this way. At the moment when the realization came, I don't have to be a slave. I'm a son. What am I doing here? And so this morning, we're going to sing this again. And you know, if you need to come down to this altar and just declare this over yourself, that there's a freedom and there's a liberty. The moment when our minds change and no longer do I identify with being, you know, just bowled over with the weight. There is a weight with sin. There is a weight that comes from not being a son and not moving to that place of maturity and knowing that God loves me and he has a plan for me. And I just want to encourage you this morning, if there's weight in your life, if there's a place where you feel shackled and fettered to something, that and even if you don't know Jesus this morning, there's a yoke this morning. This morning my devotion was in this, and it says in Matthew 11, it says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden and overburdened, and I will cause you to rest. I will ease and relieve and refresh your souls. Take my yoke." See, there's yokes out there. There's two different kinds. There's the one for the slave and there's the one for the son. And he says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me." He wants to teach us. He's a good father. "For I am gentle and meek and humble and lowly in heart, and you will find rest, relief and ease and refreshment and recreation and a blessed quiet for your souls." And then in whatever the tumultuous thing you're going through, and whatever you're seeing or whatever's causing your heart to be unrest, his yoke is easy, his burden is light. And he says, "Come and let me teach of you." And it goes on to say this, "For my yoke is wholesome, it is useful, it is good, it is not harsh or hard or sharp or pressing, but comfortable and gracious and pleasant." Too many times we haven't sought the way of holiness, or we haven't sought the way of maturity, because we think there's going to be a pain involved. And while there is a pain, it's the ripping away of things that don't belong to you. Okay? It's the taking away of the burden and the consequence of sin. See, the consequence of sin is death. But he has come that we could have life, and life more abundantly. And if this morning, if you're just like, you know what, I want that abundant life, as saying, you know what, I'm not a believer in Jesus Christ, but I want to be, then that's where you come on down. And if you're saying, you know, I am a believer, but there's too much stuff attached, that's where you come on down. And as we just worship this morning, as our worship team, it's a song. In Zephaniah, it says he sings songs of deliverance over us. It's a beautiful thing when your God, your Father, looks down and sings a song of deliverance, because joy rises up in your soul, because there's hope again, there's faith again, strength is renewed. So this morning, Father, we thank you. Let's sing it again.
I am a child of God.
Jimmy, just sing that chorus over us one more time.
So we're no longer slaves to you. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. I am a child.
God. There's no fear in love. There's no fear in love. There's no fear in love. You set us free, Lord. You set us free, God. There's no fear in your love. We can go forth without fear, 'cause you have set us free, you have set us free, God. Thank you.
There's just such a heart of the Father in this place. The heart of a nurturer, the heart of the head of the home. There's just a safe place in here. He's drawing us in. His sons and daughters, the heart of the family is here.
Of who you are can just encounter the fullness of who we are this morning, and that you're transforming us from the inside out. We thank you this morning for the victory in Christ Jesus. We thank you this morning for the victory on the cross. We thank you this morning you don't leave us naked and afraid, but you call us your own. So we thank you this morning that we are sons and we are daughters, and that we engage with our awesome Abba Father in that way this morning. Father, we thank you that this morning we've gained strength. This morning we've let go of burdens. This morning you've touched the deepest parts of us and caused healing, health, and life to come. And for that, we give you all the glory and all the praise this morning. We give you praise. Give him praise this morning. Just thank him. The fruit of your lips be praise. Father, let the fruit of our lips be praise. For you're a good, good God. We thank everyone for coming this morning. We just want to welcome you to Epic Church. You can just continue in worship as we look to the screens. My name is Pastor Stephanie Renavales. I'm our connections pastor here at Epic, along with my husband. We serve here. And we just want to welcome you to Epic, where we value the presence of God and we value his people. And just a few short announcements are going to go on the screen in a second, but the Intercessors Rally is coming up in August. That's if you have a call to intercession or you're interested. It's $15. It includes a light lunch and continental breakfast and training materials. And then there's also a women's thing coming up. So they're all in the announcements, but just things that require signups are in the information center. So if you'll turn your attention to the screen.
And welcome to Epic Church. We are blessed to have you with us this morning as we join together to worship Jesus. We have some exciting opportunities for you to participate in. Keep watching for more details.
Go ahead, pull out your phones and check in on Facebook. Share with the world what God is doing here in Lakeland.
Tuesdays at 6:30 is all church prayer. Come and join us as we pray for our church community and the world.
Attention, Epic ladies. Let's get together for dinner. Reservations are already made Saturday, August 20th, 5 p.m. at Abuelo's at Lakeside Village. Yum! $5 reserves your seat as space is limited. Hope to see everyone there.
You're invited to the Epic Intercessors Rally August 19th and 20th, open to people of all ages at Epic from 16 and on. Include your light breakfast, lunch, training materials, and you can register online or in the information center.
Hello, Epic family. Pastor Michael here. I'd like to give a shout out to all our team leaders, team members, and those interested in being in leadership here at Epic Church. Pastor Shirley and I would like to invite you for a time of leadership training on August 4th and August 18th at 7:30 p.m. here at Epic. We're so excited about this time of training and look forward to seeing each of you there. Please sign up at the Information Center in our lobby.
Get ready. It's offering time.
Good morning, Epic. My name is Jared Parks. My wife and I are sons and daughters in this body, or a son and a daughter in this body. Very excited that I have the opportunity to receive offering this morning. So we were traveling a lot these last couple of weeks. We went to New York, a couple places. We did a dance camp, all this stuff. And we realized when we got back, I was like, man, we didn't pay our tithe while we were gone. And so you know that initial thought is like, what am I going to do? So we started writing the check out, and the number was bigger than what I was trying to put on. I was like, man, am I looking short over here? Hold up. And as I began to, you know, think through those things, I heard the Lord just say, it's about your heart. It's about your heart. I care more about your heart. And I just want to kind of paraphrase the story of Cain and Abel as I receive offering this morning. And you guys can bring the baskets up. You're more than welcome to come. I don't mind. And I think about these two different offerings that were brought before the Lord. One of Cain, that he worked the land and he made this offering and it looked really good. It was the shiniest fruit. It was the juiciest of the juiciest. I mean, it was fresh vegetables. It was everything that you would think looks great. And then you think about the offering of Abel, where it was bloody and it was a portion of the firstborn of the flock that he watched, that he tended. And God received that offering over Cain's offering. But what was interesting about the story was when Cain was upset that his offering wasn't accepted, basically he asked the Lord, or the Lord asked him and said, why is your countenance fell? And why are you angry? And right there it was like, man, God didn't say, why was your offering raggedy? Why did you give me something that I didn't require? He said, He cared about his heart. He said, why is your countenance fell? Why are you angry? And so God looks at your heart and why you give. And so my question today is, what kind of heart, what kind of offering are you bringing today? Is it begrudgingly, oh man, I just got a little bit left, I'm going to bring it? Or do you come with joy? Do you give the Lord what is his and only his? And so I want to encourage you today as we first take our tithe before we do our offering. And I love that God gives us a command to bless us. How cool is it? He says, you know, test me in this. It's like he gives me a command, so I know I have to do it, but it's only so that he can bless me and bless us. That's a beautiful thing. And so as you prepare your tithe this morning, think about that. Where is your heart? Are you giving an offering that is something that you made up? Has it become mundane in your life? Is something that you only think about on Sunday mornings? Or do you really begin to ask the Lord, okay, God, what do you want? How do you want it? What can I do outside of just bringing resources into the storehouses? How am I offering my life up to the people around me at my job? How am I living my life in a way that this world has changed? Think about that. And as you come, you can, everybody please stand. We're going to take our tithe first, like I said, and just come on up. Kind of do it in this body is we take our tithe first and then we give our offering. And I really thought about this giving your offering. And I read John 3:16, and mostly when you hear that, it's like, oh, that's about salvation. And it is. But I think it's a beautiful example of what real love looks like. Love is not gimme, 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 but it's to give. To give. And not just give, but he gave his best. He gave his only begotten son for us. And just think about that today as you come and as you give your offering, that give your best to God because he gave his best to you. Come and give. Let us pray. Father, we thank you, God, for who you are. We thank you not only for the things that you provide us with, God, but for your heart towards us, that you gave your very best to us. What an honor and what a privilege it is to be able to give and to be blessed and to worship you with everything that's in us, God. So we present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you, God, to your service. We are at your service, Lord. Bless these tithes and bless these offerings that people have given of themselves, Lord. And let the return be far greater than we ever could ask, think, or imagine. We love you and we thank you for the mandate on this house to go. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. God is good. A great teacher once said to me that rumors fly and truth leaks. And so it speaks to often sometimes that we don't always get, or people don't always get to hear our truth, that the rumors, we like to hear the bad stuff, the, you know, that juicy stuff, and we spread that like wildfire, and that just kind of goes, it just feeds something that is innate inside of us, innate this human vessel, it just thrills it, and it goes out. But I want to say that let's let truth have its day. Let's let truth fly, because it occurs to me that when the birth of the church took place and the upper room experience took place, that truth flew. that when Lakeland experienced something, most recently probably like the Lakeland outpouring and other things that have happened in Lakeland that we're all very familiar with and some of us have been, you know, intimately involved with, truth had its day. Truth was able to fly and get out and reach beyond. Everybody was telling everybody about everything that was going on. You couldn't keep it quiet. It was on the radio. It was on the TV. Everywhere, anybody who was anybody around this area was talking about what was going on there. It was in everywhere you went. If you went into Burger King, you could hear people talking about what was going on and what was happening and what God was doing. And so today I want to talk to us about I am whose I am. We are guilty by association. Whoever it is that we associate with, we start with simply our last name. Our last name identifies us to a specific family. And when we trace our roots all the way back, it could belong to a clan or a tribe or somewhere where we shake the family tree and find out where we were a part of. And it represented a group of people that was either a location or meant something or where it was where we have been identified or associated or guilty by association. We are whose we are. Who we belong to and what we are a part of speaks louder than sometimes even our own words and sometimes even our own actions. We are guilty by association. And it was obvious that the Israelites was the chosen people of God, and they were guilty by association. In that sense, it is a very good thing. And I want to share with you the words of Moses today to kind of make it clear what I mean that I am or we are whose we are. Exodus chapter 33 and verse 15. Now, this is right after God told them to go and do something, and this is what was going to happen. And so Moses said to the Lord, "If your presence doesn't take the lead here, call this trip off right now. How else will it be known that you're with me in this, with me and your people? Are you traveling with us or not? How else will we know that we're special, I and your people, among all other people on this planet Earth?" Being identified with God was the deciding factor in their lives. It is the only thing in Moses' and the Israelites' mind that set them apart from any other person anywhere else on the earth. It is what identified them. And Moses made the claim that I am not going to go anywhere without you. Because that is the only thing that makes us guilty by association, and that's what I'm going to hang on to. So I think what it is that we've moved in our lives where it's like a contract where we're leased people, and our lease is up. And we're deciding whether we want to renew this lease or not, this covenant with God. And we go through these phases in our life and cycles in our life, and sometimes it's 3 months and sometimes it's 5 minutes, where I liked what you said right here, but now that I've woke up this morning and you've asked me to do this, I'm not so sure that I want to sign that lease agreement. And so we go through cycles in our life, 6 months, a year, 2 years, where we come back to the place to where we have to renew our lease with God or renew our vows in the marriage sense of the word. Come back to God and say, "I really now realize what I have with you and who I am because of who you are." And so we face this place and we find this place in our lives where we've got to sign the contract again to renew our lease with God, because we can start peeling away and start going back because we've forgotten who we said yes to. We've forgotten who we can say yes to. We've forgotten who can live in our hearts and take over our minds and move us into a place of the miraculous that we've never known before, a place of prosperity that we've never known found before. And so we find ourselves in that place of renewal, and I think Moses found himself there. It was like this lease agreement, and it's like, all right, you've done everything I want you to do up to this point, so I'm going to let you just go on. And he's like, no, it's renewal day, and I'm going to re-sign this contract, and you're going with me, or I'm not signing the contract. I'm not signing up for this, because I am who you are. That's how I know who I am, because I know who you are. And because I know who you are, I know who we are. And we are special and set apart and chosen, and we have a God that opens up Red Seas for us. We have a God that will provide manna from heaven for us. We have a God that will call us to a promised land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and make sure that we overtake every enemy and every obstacle in our path to do so. Whatever it is, you need some rules? Here's some Ten Commandments for you. You need something else? All right, let's build a temple, and I'll give you a place where my presence descends and you can worship me. What do you need? Moses says, I know who I am because I know whose I am. And so we first ask the question, who is God? Well, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So we know that God is the creator God of all things. We know who he was associated with, who associated God with God. Who knew God? We talk about Enoch, who didn't die. He knew God so well and just walked around every day with God that God just took him up. I mean, what? How does that happen? I mean, we're just walking and talking. He's like, you know what, Enoch? I like you. Why don't you just come on with me? Okay, let's do that. I mean, we've got Elisha who goes up in the chariot. What? That man knew God. Then we have David. Now, David was a little, he was back and forth. Now, if you read the Psalms, it's like that first half, it's like, oh my gosh, all my enemies are coming around me. And it was that, and those were the times he had to renew his lease. He had gotten in a place where he started looking at the physical and no longer identifying with the spiritual. And he starts off, oh, many are they that trouble me. My enemies are all around me. And it was like in the midst of that, he got inspiration. But you, oh God, are my strong tower, my refuge, and my strength. That's who I want to sign up with. That's who I want to renew a lease with. I want to ante up to that right there. I can identify with that. I don't want to identify with sorrow. I don't want to belong to sorrow, because when we belong to sorrow, we begin to express sorrow, and sorrow comes all over us and all a part of our life, and we are identified by whose we are. And we're identified by sorrow or depression or doubt or murmuring or gossiping. But if we can identify with the God, who else knew him? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I would say, knew him pretty good. They got real close in that fire. Woo! I thought Florida was hot. I would say they knew him pretty good. I think Daniel knew him pretty well. That takes a lot of trust to identify with the King of Kings whom you have not seen. So much so that you're willing to be thrown in a den of flesh-eating lions. I don't want to go near the glass at the zoo. And there's just like one lion and they're like asleep. I have to like look really hard to find them. I mean, they're not like actively seeking. They're fed all the time, you know. I don't want to get involved with that. I think Jonah knew him pretty well. Jonah was at a place he wasn't ready to renew the lease. And he chose not to sign the lease and go in the opposite direction of the lease and evict himself from the place where he was at and try to move into another place that wasn't. But he had forgotten all along that the lease is only on my side. Once I gave him my yes, he's faithful and just to make sure that I'm going to be everything that he called me to be because I've already said my yes. So even though I don't sign the lease, he's already signed it permanently. It's this golden signature that cannot be penetrated, broken, ripped, torn, shredded, melted, or any other way destroyed. He's already signed an agreement that is going to assure that you become. And so Jonah, saying, I'm not signing this lease, I'm getting up out of here, finds himself in the belly of a whale. I don't know how that worked. I mean, I can't imagine the inside of a whale. I mean, that's messed up. But I would get the point after that. And thank God he came out the front end, you know? I mean, that could have been a whole terrible thing if God had let that process take place. You know what I'm saying? Thank God he was thrown up on the beach, man. I'm like, because that could have been a really trying process for him, you know? He'd have really known the Lord at the end of that now. Yes, sir. He'd have known his place in this world. So we go from who is God to what is God. Well, we know that God is a giver. He sent his only begotten Son, the once and for all sacrifice that fulfilled and satisfied the old covenant in every way by providing this once and for all sacrifice. And thus opening a new covenant by which we can believe in the high priest Jesus and ask him to come into our hearts and cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. And as a result of that, have an eternal promise to spend eternity with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and God in the kingdom of heaven. What is he? He's our Savior. He's a giver. He's the one who performs the miraculous all the time. He's the one who continues to create and do things over and over and over again. And Jesus did all of these things. He was the once and for all sacrifice. He was the satisfier of the old covenant, the creator of the new covenant, and just happened to train 12 people while he was here and performed a couple of miracles along the way. That's what God is. He is ever concerned and caring for his chosen people, always providing a way for them to have a way in him and identify with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So we go who, we go what, and we ask when. When is the moment that you say yes? When is the moment when we say, I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Please come into my heart, O God. Forgive me of all my sins. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And lead, guide, and direct me from henceforth to your according to your will and your purpose for why you created me here. That is the when that God begins to take you on a journey and identify who you are, because you have a Savior living inside of you every day, every minute of every hour, and he's asking you to sign up again and renew your lease one more time so that you can begin to move into the place, because we've forgotten the power of the one who lives inside of us. To stress this point and give us a clear understanding of who it is that we serve and who it is that is inside of our heart, there's a comedian who now has a talk show, and his name is Steve Harvey. Now, I do not condone this man or necessarily believe that we should live by what he says. He is funny. He's funny. And not everything he says he should say. But there are some things that he says that are funny. However, there was a moment in one of his comedy shows where he ended it by introducing Jesus Christ. Now, I've watched this video over and over and over again, and if it can affect him like it affected him at the end of that, The man had a true revelation in his own comic routine of who God was and is, who Jesus is, and what he can do. And in that moment, he confesses the name of Jesus. In that moment, he lifts his hand and acknowledges the one who gave him all the abilities that he has. In that moment, he could not help, once he had a true revelation and once he began to share these words and begin to introduce Christ to that group, he had a true revelation of who God is. And so I want to remind everyone today who it is that's in our hearts and who it is that can function through us if we'll let him, and who it is that we're called to introduce to this world. Because when we know who's inside of us, it doesn't matter what anybody might say. It doesn't matter the weird and strange looks we get by doing things that seem out of the ordinary of the plans of this world, which I am not concerned about, but acknowledging the plans of the Most High God, of whose plans I am concerned about. And I want to behave in a manner that pleases him and releases kingdom on this earth. And I don't care that it doesn't look like everything else. And I don't care that I'm not the quiet, reserved person who's sitting and abiding by all of the social norms that everybody's trying to enforce around us all the time. I don't care, because I know who's inside of me and I know who I want to renew a lease with. I don't want to renew a lease with the world. I don't want to identify or be guilty by associating with this world so much that I look and smell like it in every way. I want them to know and smell and sense that I'm kingdom. I want them to know what it is that is inside of me. And so I want to remind us today who it is that we serve. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor to introduce a man who needs no introduction. His credits are too long to list. He has done the impossible time after time. He hails out of a manger in Bethlehem, Jerusalem, by way of heaven. His mother is still headlining in the Catholic Church today. His daddy is the author of a book that has been on the bestseller list since the beginning of time. He holds the record for the world's greatest fish fry. He fed 5,000 hungry souls with 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. He can walk on water and turn water into wine with no special effects and no camera tricks. He has a headshot on every church fan across the country. Even before the kings of comedy, he was hailed the king of all kings, ruler of the universe, Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, the bright and the morning star. Some say he's the Rose of Sharon, and some say he's the Prince of Peace. So if you're with me this morning, get up on your feet and show your love for the King of Kings, the Redeemer of all things, the one who lives inside of your heart right now, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Something like that I want to sign up for. That's somebody who I want to sign an agreement with. That's somebody I want to get connected to. That's somebody that I want to share. That's somebody that I want to let this world know that this is what I'm a part of. I want to let the world know that this is what I identify with. I want to be guilty by association. I want to associate with the Most High God. And because I've associated so strongly, so mightily, and so connected with Him, that everybody knows without a doubt whose I am and who I am because of whose I am. And I want to sign up again and begin to renew that process for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is who's living inside of you right now, this very second. Every minute of every hour of every day, that's who we can call upon. The one who can say, peace be still, and everything stop. The one who can walk out on water when you're a boat in the middle of the sea and don't know what you're doing. One who can break bread and feed 5,000. One who can turn water into wine when it's necessary. One who can pray for the sick and the sick will recover. That's who I want to associate with today. That's who I want to be identified with. That's who's following you around all the time, everywhere you go. Let us sign up again. Let us renew our lease with Him. Let us come back and, as David did, put every complaint aside and worry and every face of the enemy that we put in front of us, and let us say, but God, you are my strong tower, my refuge and my strength. In you will I trust. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Today, we have Jesus Christ inside of us. We have the opportunity to re-up with Him and move into a place where we are sharing who He is and not worrying about anything else. Hallelujah. I just want us to know who we are. Once we know who we are, there's nothing we can't do. When we know whose we are, we can then know who we are. And when we know who we are, we can do what we need to do. And that is what I want for everyone in here. There's nothing like it in the world. Jonah, in the end, knew who he was. David, in the end, knew who he was. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, if they didn't know before, they knew after the fire. David knew for Daniel knew for sure after the lion's den. There was no doubt, there was no question. And it is time for truth to fly and rumors to leak. We need to let the truth within us begin to fly and release and begin to, somebody needs to open up the faucet inside of us and begin to release. That is what is inside of you. Why not open up the faucet? Why not open up the vessel? Why not let it flood everything that is of this earth that is not of God? Why not overtake it? Why not overflow? Why not? Because we're no longer a slave. I am a child. And we can put whatever we want. No longer a slave to fear. No longer a slave to doubt. No longer a slave to whatever. The enemy's plans. Because I am a child of the Most High God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you identify with that today, come on and give Him a shout. If you're ready to release something inside of you, that's what I'm talking about today. That's what I'm talking about today. That's what we've got to do. We've got to recognize who's inside of us and let it go and let it be released. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We have our ministry elders who are here to pray. Our ministry prayer team is available as well to pray for you and agree with you about anything. If you need to know this one that I talked about today and you need to ask Him into your heart, we can pray that prayer. If you need baptism of the Holy Spirit like it was at the birth of the church, that's what we can do, and we can pray with that. If you need healing in your body, or if you just need to renew your contract and you want a witness there to do that and agree with you, we want to do that today. This area is open for you. For the rest of you, God bless you. Go out and change somebody's life this week and let truth fly. Hallelujah. Yes. Remember whose you are. Hallelujah.